What do you do when reality splinters? You don't know who to trust. You don't even know it's real. I'm Ed Eddy. You're watching $2 Horror. Hey everybody, we're talking Coherence, written and directed by James Ward Beerkit, starring Emily Foxer and Elizabeth Grayson, everybody's favorite Highlander character, Amanda. So this movie is largely improvised. I guess writer-director James Ward Beerkit came up with the idea to make this movie because he wanted to make a movie without a script. He chose to film it in his own home. The actors were given daily notes, like sort of guiding them where to go, you know, their backstories and motivations and everything. It gives a really natural feel to all of the dialogue that happens in the movie.
Everyone else still not have service?
I didn't even check.
My phone is completely broken.
I'm living in the moment, but...
Nothing.
I got zero. No.
It's weird. Maybe the tower's down.
I'm sure I have none.
The tower's down?
No.
Like, I mean, it's not telling you guys. It's not down.
That would be a big news story.
So 8:30 to 40-somethings have gathered at a home. They're having a dinner party. Loosely, they're celebrating the passage of Miller's Comet, but, you know, it's just an excuse to get together and then have their party. Everybody brings all their baggage with them, all their problems that they're gonna have to work through throughout the movie. First thing that's out of the ordinary that happens is all the cell phones are down. The movie starts off, we're in the car with the main character, M, played by Emily Foxler. She's talking on the phone with somebody. Her phone cuts out and then just cracks in her hand. And we get to the party, we start meeting all the characters. We start learning we start learning a little bit of their backstories and who they are as characters. Beth, played by Elizabeth Grayson, has, I don't know if I'd call it a drug problem, but she's definitely a recreational drug user. She has a little vial of ketamine. I think she's a very anxious and kind of stressed out person, so she medicates to help cope with that. Mike is a failed actor. He wasn't actually failed. He apparently was on some show for, you know, a number of years. We have Amir, who is M's ex. He's showing up with his new lady love, Lori. Hugh and Beth are married. So they're all sitting around the table. They're talking about, you know, the comet and everything. And Hugh starts telling a story about a comet that passed. And there are people in Finland in 1930, and M corrects him, it's 1923. There's a comet that passes over and people in Finland start getting confused and lost.
It was actually crazy because it affected the people. They would, after it passed, they would get lost. They would end up in the wrong home. They would forget things. They wouldn't really know where they were. And I remember reading about this one woman who called the police and said, "The man in my house is not my husband." And then the police came over and they said, "This is your husband." She said, "No, this is not my husband. I killed my husband yesterday.
Awesome.
That's how I know it's not him." Awesome. But they couldn't arrest her because he was standing right there in front of them.
All right, so we're gonna start getting into the story of this movie, and I'm not really sure how to talk about it without spoiling it, so you should know going forward that I'm gonna be revealing a lot of things about the plot of this movie. So go watch it if you haven't seen it, because this movie is fantastic. I really love this movie. So if you're on the fence about it, just go watch it right now. It's on Prime, it's on Tubi as well. Okay, so here we go, the power goes out. This is when the plot kicks in. This is when reality splits. They go outside because they've noticed that the power is out in the whole entire neighborhood, except for this one house that's maybe two blocks away. So they all go out to look at it. They see the comet passing them by. They all go back inside. Hugh is worried about his brother, who's, you know, his brother is like a physicist, and he says, if anything weird happens during the comet, you know, get in touch with me. I'll tell you what to do. So he wants to go to this other house that's two blocks away that still has power. He wants to see if they have a landline and a phone that they can use. And they crack open this box of blue glow sticks. So that, you know, I guess so they don't get hit by cars and they don't get separated. Because Hugh and this other guy go. Hugh and Amir go off to go to this house and try and use a landline. They got their blue glow sticks with them. That's pretty important. So all the other characters are stuck inside without power. And all of a sudden there is this loud pounding on the door. And the power comes back on.
Oh my God! Oh!
What the hell was that? I don't know.
Hugh and Amir come back. Hugh's got this injury on the left side of his head. And Amir explains that he went into the house, I think, and he found this lockbox. And we don't know why, but he decides that he's going to take it. So he takes it, brings it back. You know, they have a little ethical debate about whether they should open it or not, but Mike is just like, the hell with it, I'm opening it. So he picks the lock, and in it they find like a ping pong paddle, I think, and they find photos of themselves, each with a number written on the back. M recognizes her own handwriting on the back of these photos. We have a shot of Hugh looking pointedly at the box of blue glow sticks. Come to find out that his brother had left him a package that his wife Beth put in the back of his car. It felt like a book, so Hugh goes out to get it. He comes back with the book. It's called Gravitation, An Introduction to Current Research. And so here we kind of flesh out the plot of the movie a little more.
Do you guys know what Schrodinger's cat is?
I'm allergic.
So it's a thought experiment. There's a cat in a box that has like a 50-50 chance of living because there's a vial of poison that's also in the box. So regular physics would say that it's one or the other, that the cat is either alive or dead. But Brian would argue that quantum physics says that both realities exist simultaneously, and it's only when you open the box that they collapse into a single event, right? So listen to this. This is what he's written. There is another theory that two states continue to exist separate and decoherent from each other, each creating a new branch of reality based on the two outcomes. Quantum decoherence ensures that the different outcomes have no interaction with each other.
So they're figuring out what's going on. They're figuring out that reality has split and there's others, there are other versions of them. Mike is a recovering alcoholic. He's getting paranoid. He's saying, if other Mike is over there, he's thinking what I'm thinking, which is I should just go kill all of them right now and solve the problem. So what if he's over there thinking that? But they somehow figure out that the other house hasn't opened the book yet. And so two of the characters are like, let's go break into other Hugh's car. And get their copy of the book so that they don't realize what's going on. And that way we have the upper hand to survive the night or whatever. But then we cut to a scene of Hugh and Amir. They're off in a separate room. And they've got red glow sticks.
Not even cracked.
Okay. What are we gonna do?
We have to get the fuck out of here.
Okay. Okay, let's take...
We take the book.
Take the book.
We take the box.
Take the box.
Take it.
This is what...
And they're like, what the hell are we doing here? We gotta get out of here. We're in some serious trouble. And so they grab the lockbox, the photos, and they hightail it out of there. And we get a large chunk of character development. From here, a good 20-25 minutes of people bickering, kind of establishing their characters a little more, and you learn more about their motivations and what's driving them and how they're going to react to these stressful situations. And so this is where M figures out that Beth and Lee are the only people original in the house. Everybody else, except for those two, have left the house at one time or another. And so she's concluding that she has wandered back into a different house. There's a different set of friends, and everybody else, except for Beth and Lee, have done the same thing because they never left that house. This is when they decide to make their own lockbox using the photos. You know, they write numbers on the back of them. They choose a random object so that they know when they, if they leave, then they come back into this house, they can open up that box, see that object, and know that they're in the right reality. But they all discover that they remember different numbers on the backs of their photos, and each and every one of them remembers a different object from the lockbox that they had earlier. So, you know, who knows how many houses and how many versions of them we're dealing with at this point. A figure comes in and attacks Mike. They pull him off Mike, and he hightails it out of there. We see it's a different version of Mike. He's got a green glow stick at this point. So this is when M decides she's had enough of all of this. She's just gonna leave and take her chances. We get a cool little montage of M peeking into windows of all these different houses and seeing different things going on, you know, versions of herself and all her friends reacting differently to the stressful situation, handling it differently. I think in one of the scenes we see two different versions of Mike. They've got him tied up, one with a red glow stick, one with a green glow stick. All right, so I know I spoiled a lot for you here. If you've seen the movie, you know how this movie ends. If you haven't, I'm not going to spoil the ending for you because it's kind of out of left field. But this movie is just perfection. I love this movie. I've seen it 5, maybe 10 times by now. Everything about it, for being a low-budget movie, for being mostly improvised dialogue, just having, like, you know, they're given the beats of where the story is supposed to go, but the actors do this really tremendous job of improvising dialogue and just really selling the whole thing. I would absolutely recommend watching this movie. It's one of my favorites. I know it's not technically horror, but who cares? It's just a YouTube channel. Who gives a shit? Okay, everybody, thanks for watching. My name's Matt Eddy. You've been watching $2 Horror. Don't let anybody give you shit for watching movies all the time because their world sucks. See you next time. We'll be right back.